Welcome to the Mr. Nobody podcast. Episode 32.
Episode 32.
So last night in my dream, I got high. I'm not sure if it was the residual effects of
the DMT
I took a few weeks ago. But there was a feeling. I'm not even sure what I used to get high, whether it was smoking something.
I think I remember injecting myself with a needle.
But there was a free fall.
In my mind.
In my dream, it was connected to what my son was after, what he was
seeking
through heroin.
The feeling of falling in slow motion.
Looking up as the world flew past me, as I sank into negative space, speeding up, falling. Dreaming this. What is this supposed to be telling me? It wasn't a good feeling. It was just clear to me
that I couldn't control it.
I was letting go of my life. I was surrendering all
connection.
Connection. Disconnected from everything. Untethered. Flying.
Falling.
Not flying. Into an oblivion that revealed to me my deepest identity. But disconnected me from life. Pretty weird. Can you understand that? I say it connected me to my deepest identity because
there was nothing else.
There was just my fear and my relinquishing of that fear. Because I was already dead, or at least no longer in danger of dying. I can't say I wanted this to be the case. I couldn't help thinking that this is what
my son was feeling when he was dying.
The first rush of heroin,
fentanyl,
into oblivion, and then finally silence.
Or at least
leaving this world.
I had the feeling of a thousand waterfalls rushing into a sinkhole. And disappearing.
The whole thing was pretty druggy, and I couldn't get out of it, at least not the way I came into it.
Side of a car. carnival that I wasn't attending, but they had one of those things, one of those water tanks with a bench and a target.
Off the beaten track of the carnival, hidden from view like a red-headed stepchild that doesn't seem to belong to the family. The guy who was manning the water tank was fucking brilliant. He was like a low-rent clown. He had a striped shirt on, some suspenders. He was like middle-aged, a bit out of shape. His hair was all fucked up. He had a red nose on.
The funny part of it was,
as if that's not funny enough, he had a microphone that was
very loud.
And he was taunting all the macho guys that were walking by with their girlfriends.
Hey, loser. Come on, you weakling. Take a shot. Don't think you can do it? I don't either. You ain't got nothing. Idiot. Loser.
Funny shit. Because you would just see these guys bristle. And in the time I was parked in traffic along the side of this carnival, watching this spectacle, this anthropological exercise, three or four guys approached the water tank, bought their five balls, and sometimes as many as 15, to try to dunk this guy because he made them angry. And he questioned their masculinity and their strength. And it was funny as shit. He knew just how to trigger their emotional responses. And no matter what those guys did, they couldn't make up for the insult. They couldn't pedal that back. It was too late for their girlfriends to unhear it. And maybe they could have laughed it off if it really didn't matter to the guys. But the guys that stopped and got pissed and were determined to dunk this guy, it mattered to them. And it was one of those, people often display that which they're afraid they don't possess. A couple of them did succeed in hitting the target and dunking the insulting clown, but undeterred, he climbed back on, put that trapdoor bench back up, and launched back in.
That's all you got? Loser. Hey, your girlfriend's looking at me. Ah, idiot. Loser.
That kind of thing. It was great. Never forgot it. I can still see him sitting up on that bench. And when it hit, and he had to plunge into the pool, he didn't fight it. He just relaxed and went with it.
Some good old-fashioned fun, folks. Anyway, back to the dream.
My phone is ringing. Let me just see what this is.
You have reached the Sundance Vacations customer experience team.
I didn't call.
We can't wait to help you find the perfect vacation destination.
Uh-huh.
Please hold briefly while we finish with a fellow traveler.
Right, as if.
This is regarding your promotional trip. Please call the number listed on your travel certificate.
My what?
Hi, this is Bill. Welcome to Sundance Vacations.
Hey, Bill. I really can't talk right now. I'm working.
Well, we were just calling to see if you wanted to take a fabulous trip anytime soon.
Yeah, maybe after the plague subsides?
Sure, there is that.
Uh-huh.
But many people are choosing to ignore that and go on vacation anyway.
Uh-huh. Yeah, at their own peril, don't you think?
I understand.
And some countries don't even want you there.
I might feel the same way. But we all need to get a little time in the sun.
Mm-hmm.
Let me ask you a question.
Sure.
If you could go anywhere in the world on the Eastern Seaboard, where would you go?
Dream. That's what it was like, sitting on a bench bottom fell out uncontrollably on drugs.
And I had that feeling of not even bothering to try to catch myself, because that would be impossible. And the more I thought about trying, the more absurd it was, because the whole point was to lose the bottom. And it wasn't just terrifying in the sense of not knowing where I'd end up, but it was also nauseating, like
the speed of the fall.
I recently went over the handlebars of my scooter. A year and a half ago, I broke my foot. Well, somebody broke it for me by stomping on it accidentally. I heard it break. Shit.
I'm not gonna be able to train for as long as this takes to heal.
That was my thought. So I pretended it wasn't broken. I did a gig that weekend.
Walked around with a cane, stupid. But Monday, got an X-ray.
I was supposed to have this guitar lesson with a great guitar player, and I got up to his place off of the subway. I couldn't walk, couldn't move. So all my denial was really for nothing. Maybe it's not denial, maybe that's just straight up willfully lying. Denial is when you really, really believe something is other than what it is. Like if I believed my son was still alive, and really thought he was, even after seeing him in his coffin.
All ashen and stiff.
Anyway, not even able to get the 3 blocks to my lesson, I had to figure something out. I remember there was this little tiny bike shop right there.
Maybe they have a scooter.
I hobbled across the street, got inside, and asked the guy,
Hey man,
do you happen to have a scooter that's big enough for me to
stand on with this shit?
And he had one.
This is important because my son was a skateboarder. He went to skateboard camp a couple times, and I could never skateboard. But the scooter that he brought me basically had a skateboard for the bottom platform.
And it was fucking beautiful. And I bought it. Got outside, and I was able to stand on it, even with my broken foot, and ride to my lesson.
I've been riding it ever since.
And that's how I get around.
The other day,
I was on my way to this little job that I took. I realized that
I was looking down
and my feet were over my head. I must have hit
a hole
and up I went, flying through the air.
Everything was moving in slow motion, just like in the dream when the bottom fell out. Very similar feeling. And everything was silent. And eternal. Like floating in space. Seemed to be no imminent landing, at least for a moment.
Hi, this is Bill.
Hey, Bill. I really can't talk right now. Okay.
Well, we were just calling to see if you wanted to take a fabulous trip.
I was suspended.
In the air, on a city street, upside down, about to hit the pavement.
But it was calm.
There was no need to try to stop it. That's what I'm getting at here. There was a surrender to the reality I could not control.
Hi, this is Bill, looking for Mr. Nobody.
Hey, Bill, how you doing?
Well, we'd like to update you of a special offer we've got for just a very select number of clients.
I understand, Bill, but this is really...
Well, this is something that we have not offered.
Bill, I'm so sorry, but I'm currently in the air, about to hit the ground, and that's going to just have to take precedent over
this
phone call at this moment.
Okay, well, you have a pleasant flight.
You too, Bill.
Mm-hmm.
It's not Bill's fault. He's in sales, and he's got a job.
Anyway.
I did hit the ground, and so on. It wasn't terrible. I got up to my feet and looked around, and there was one lady
with her mouth open
and a look of terror on her face.
Like the Edvard Munch painting, The Scream.
I gave her the thumbs up, which in some cultures doesn't say something very nice. But in our culture, it says
everything's cool,
fine, overall good experience,
I suppose.
Being high like that in my dream, it felt real.
Scarily real.
Hi, this is Bill.
Just a word on interruptions. It's amazing how much we're all interrupted all the time, and that we even interrupt ourselves
through a constant
self-badgering process of trying to feel
connected
or perhaps rewarded. And I'll give you an example that's been bothering me. You know that I do these
little podcasts.
I like to think that I'm above needing to be rewarded
for my story,
even to the point where I call myself a nobody and I never mention
my name or my son's name.
But I'm going to tell you the truth. Since I've joined up
certain social media accounts
at the advent of this podcast, before that I did not have those,
I've gotten a little bit hooked
on the reward system. And I notice a feeling inside of me,
an unease
about that,
that I've begun to need it.
The clown is taunting me to throw a ball, and that if it doesn't meet my expectations, there's a letdown.
I see people checking their phones 30 times
a minute,
and I've started doing that.
So I'm going to counteract that by just not doing it, by just letting my true feelings about what happened to my son and to other people's sons and daughters, mothers, fathers, brothers and sisters, and especially my own story, just go out there and do whatever it wants. And I'm not going to worry about it. I'm not going to try to amplify it or promote it
anymore.
That would just mean I'm playing into it. I'm exploiting it. And I'm using my son to make new friends. That's been bothering me. Dreams. The way in which we
talk to ourselves.
Pictures of what's going on under the surface. I think I know what dreams are important by how I feel when I'm in them, and how I feel when I'm out. The last few nights, I've been asking for dreams about my son. That's kind of new for me.
2 years. 3 years, not 2 years.
And I don't really know what has shifted. It's been 3 years since I've seen him. So I take what I can get. And then I had this dream.
3 years, not 2 years.
I'm in a room that's covered with fabric, kind of like a tent. On the ceilings, on the walls.
The floors have rugs.
And I'm sitting in this room, and it's dark. And in my hand is a long white staff.
Remarking to myself that
it's not a dowel, but it's the branch of a tree. It's a staff. Oh good, this is something that my son and I can use to train.
I become aware
that I hear my son's voice coming from the next tented room, and I can hear that he's laughing and talking a little louder than he usually did. He's engaged. I know he's in that room with family and friends, where he's very relaxed.
Because I can tell
by the way he sounds that he's very
comfortable.
More so than he usually was. I don't want to go into that room because I do not want to interrupt.
I don't want to influence or change his space.
His connection with my presence. And I'm just drinking in the sound of his happiness, his talking. And so I sit there and I listen with this
white staff in my hands.
After a few moments, it seems like his voice has faded away. There's no longer any people in that room, and I can't hear anyone anymore. And I think, oh shit, I better
catch up with him
before I miss him. And so I duck under some part of this tent into the next
tented room.
They're all connected, like a honeycomb. And there's no one in there. There weren't even any traces that there was a gathering in that.
I'm still holding the white staff.
And I feel this urgency come upon me to go track him down.
Catch up.
I'm having this need to embrace him. And I move from this room into this long tented hallway. And it's dark in there, but there's still some light
diffusing through this tent somehow.
And I go through this hallway tent. And I remember using my staff to lift up the canvas so I could duck under into this other room. Yet another room. And I get to this one wall.
This one tented wall.
And I'm really feeling some anxiety because I'm going to miss him. And just as I'm about to lift up that next canvas,
that portion of tent,
with my staff and duck under, I realize he's gone. And there's nobody in this
tented world. Especially not him.
And this wakes me.
What does it mean?
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 His voice was so clear. And then it faded. I try to examine why I cannot let his memory be a blessing. And it may be, but it just doesn't work that way for me. And I think it has to do with the incompleteness of his potential, what it is to have a life, and how I feel particularly upset that he ended his life with something as certain to kill him as heroin. It's like he gave up, sold out, chose to separate, and left this world. I guess I think everybody knows that heroin will kill you. And if it doesn't right away, it just completely destroys who you were. He would never do that. My worst nightmare.
On the subject of baseball, I only took my son to one professional baseball game. My mother called me up. It was a Wednesday afternoon. And she said,
"What are you doing tonight?"
I was like, "I don't know. Homework."
"Well, how would you like to go to the baseball game?"
I said, "I guess I would." She had won two tickets over the radio. So she dropped those tickets off. And I picked up my son from school. And we drove the hour to the stadium. Fought our way through the crowd up into the nosebleed bleacher seats that we had. He nestled in. I was amazed at how poorly behaved this crowd was. It was the worst display of adult behavior I'd ever seen up until that point. Grown men picking fights with each other based on looks people gave them and shit like that. Completely stupid. My son didn't notice any of that.
He proceeded to eat
3 hot dogs. He was only 10 years old. So invested in the flavor.
The moment.
I don't even think he noticed the game. I did take many long looks at the beautiful
arrangement
of the game, the logic, and the poetry.
That was the one and only time we went to the ball game.
They did drag this one loud, fucking insane asshole out of screaming and yelling.
They dragged him out.
Which was not an easy task, as the pitch of that height of the bleachers was like 45 degrees, and he could have tumbled
right over the railing.
God, I miss him. Not that guy.
But my son.
Hi, this is Bill, calling from Sundance Vacation Packages.
Nobody.